Good evening to you and a warm welcome to a special series of programs. This is the November segment, and today with us in the studios is one of the founding members of SLIT, currently based in Canada at the University of Ontario Information Technology. We've got Professor Priyanta Kumaravadu. A very good evening to you.
Good evening, Sharifa.
Good to have you with us, and we did mention that you're one of the founding members of SLIT.
Yeah, that's
and,
correct.
SLIT is related to IT, so today's discussion will be basically on information technology.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite subjects anyway.
But currently, you're in Canada.
That's correct.
So how did that happen?
Actually, I've been working in SLIT for about 10 years. Mm-hmm. Then I got opportunity to work in two universities in Canada. The first university was University of Western Ontario. I work as associate professor there. Then after that, I get a chance to work at the University of Ontario Institute of Technology as a sessional professor. So I've been teaching and doing some research over there.
Interesting. And well, we see a lot of people getting into IT because it's the trend nowadays. And whenever you speak to a youth, a person who's leaving school, they'll be like, I'm going to follow IT. I'm going to do something related to computers. I'm going to do something in terms of information technology. So we see there's a growing market for jobs and also a lot of opportunities and a lot of graduates coming out. But is the Sri Lankan job market providing what they should be getting is my question.
I think so. I think this is a good point. One of the things that I want to tell you is IT is for everyone. It's not for the software engineers or who want to work in the industry. It's for everyone. So as you said, even teens, youths, adults, whoever, they all involved in IT, for example. So they are, very much into social media nowadays, Facebook and the other social media platforms and so on and so forth. I do remember 2000, which is the critical year for Sri Lankan IT industry. And World Bank did a study in 1998, 1999 around, and they found out that if Sri Lanka wanted to be one of the IT service industry, so you wanted to have about 2,000 the software engineering specialists in the country. Unfortunately, we had only about 200 to 300 graduates coming out from all the institution, including private and public. Then only so this change started. Then there's a need for a talent pool, and if the industry to go forward. And then there are a lot of institutions started, including SLIIT, and then APIIT, IIT. There are so many information technology started, and the bulk actually came from SLIIT. And then the IT industry in Sri Lanka wanted to hit the 1 billion target within about 12, 13 years. Unfortunately, we could not reach that target within the, anticipated time. One of the reason was we did not have enough talent pool in this country. And I think if you look at the talent pool, existing talent pool, so I think we have about 125,000 software engineers or the IT talent pool in this country right now. We need more. Now, the next target would be about $2 billion. So then if you want to hit that $2 billion market, of course, we have to have more, the IT professionals in this country. The more IT professionals will be trained. So there are a lot of opportunities for our kids here, or the graduates, as well as the kids who are coming out from the school. And now, if you look at the trends, now the trends have changed now, because as you can see, the information technology or computing is always fast evolving area. It's not like stagnated area. Always
exactly. You need to always be updated, and it's not enough. What you learn is not enough. You need to keep educating yourself, keep learning more. So that's I think something we need to speak on as well, Professor.
That's correct. Now, as you correctly said, it's evolving. The technology are drastically changing. And therefore, the student who wants to be in the information technology discipline, they have to update their knowledge. Now, if you look at the last maybe 12 to 20 years, and so pretty much we were into different platforms, the technology, and so on and so forth. But if you look at the next 10 years, I would say it's on the cybersecurity, because the cybersecurity is playing a vital role now. Because as I started, it's IT is all over. The software is all over. Even now, nowadays, everything is based on IT. The banks, the healthcare, You name it, everything is on IT. The security of the information is crucial. So therefore, we need a lot of security, you know, cybersecurity professionals to take care of these, the security of the systems right now. So if I just give some statistics, for example, say by 2022, the requirement of the talent pool in the world will be about 1.8 million cybersecurity specialists. 1.8 million. So I would say if you just take that down to Sri Lanka, I would say about 2,000 to 5,000, you know, the cybersecurity specialists. That's the requirement. Now, we don't have that many. I would say maybe about 100, you know, or maybe 200 max. There's a huge demand for cybersecurity specialists in this country within the next 10 years. That's where we can, you know, see the potential. Not only that, now the technologies have been changing. Now, for example, say the cloud technologies, and there are other artificial intelligence, the machine learning, robotics, all these are going to be the key technologies in the next 10 years.
So we're looking at 10 years, the future, and obviously youth are the future of this whole world.
Correct.
So basically, we are touching on Sri Lanka right now. Mm-hmm. So you said that we need quite a number of graduates in terms of cybersecurity, cloud, and
artificial intelligence,
and I think even medicine kind of counts.
Correct.
On artificial
Correct.
Intelligence as well. And yep. not only that, anything we use, from your mobile phone to
Correct.
Anything you use, has artificial intelligence.
That's
we'll
correct.
Get to that point, but then you did touch on cloud
mm-hmm.
computing. So for all those laymen out there, why don't you give them a brief idea as to what it is, because there might be school-going kids tuned in mm-hmm. and would want to know what they could follow when they leave.
Yeah. Okay. Now, these are different, the technologies or the platforms that we use in information technology or computing field. So, I mean, the kids who are coming out of the school, they can think that, you know, different areas that they should focus on, and looking at the demand, because that is one of the key things. Because we have to look at the job demand. Job demand is very important for us. For example, say now, about 2 weeks ago, I was talking to one of the, the agencies here, which takes care of the cybersecurity aspect of this country, which is SL Cert. And one specialist told me that there were a couple of guys who have been trained under them. So they have already migrated to different countries. I mean, when you compare the compensation, then it's about $6,000 to about $8,000. That's a substantial, amount of money that they get per month. So that's the demand that they have. So that means if you are a specialist who are in that, evolving areas, specialized areas, I think they have a bright future. And then sometimes our kids or the teens think that, oh, this is only for a fresh high school graduate. It's not only that. So what we are thinking is right now, if you want to have a large talent pool, we can accommodate not only the fresh graduates coming out of the school, we can even retrain the graduates. For example, I know there is quite a lot of graduates who are coming out of, especially social sciences or commerce or different arts and so on and so forth, different areas. We can sort of train or retrain them to be the subject specialists. Now, some of the cybersecurity specialists, they don't want to be highly technical. For example, say if someone is going to work in the cybersecurity governance, so they are, of course, not a really high technical guys, but pretty much like with some other background. So therefore, there is a possibility of training as well as retraining these graduates. So therefore, I think everyone has a kind of equal chance to be a specialist in this area.
Shall we touch on what exactly is cloud computing?
Yeah, the cloud computing is, for example, say now, maybe about 15 years ago or maybe 10 years ago, for example, if you look at software system, and then we have a sort of like individual sort of databases where we store the system. So that is, we have individual sort of like databases. So what we do is now we don't know do that kind of thing. So we have a huge, large, the databases or the data structures. So what we do is that we're going to share that info. It's pretty much like sharing systems. So that is about the cloud computing.
So that's cloud computing in a nutshell. But
yeah.
when you have to study, it's
yeah.
a vast topic.
Exactly.
And I think in Sri Lanka too, cloud computing is pretty famous now for big organizations
Correct.
And all that. But mm-hmm. What they consider or what they think about is security, safety, when it comes to cloud computing. You correct. Share your files with a platform, like correct. An open source platform.
That's correct.
So that brings to my next question. Cybersecurity also plays a massive role. So correct. People can also educate themselves on cybersecurity. So what aspects of cybersecurity can they touch on?
I mean, let's start from a teen's point of view, right? For example, the Facebook. These guys are always on the Facebook. Now, I have seen, like, you know, a lot of these kids, they share their photographs, their, you know, personal information, their house address, and so on and so forth. So imagine there is a hacker who hacked to the, you know, their Facebook and then all steal all this information. And then they can do a big damage. So that is one example. I can give another example. Now, for example, say we have a driverless cars. Of course, we don't see in this region. For example, if you go to California, so there are driverless cars. I mean, all these, like, you know, they have been sort of like have a trial, you know, drives. Driverless cars. So all these driverless cars are run on software. Imagine hacker hacks the, you know, the one of the driverless car, you know, where there are passengers, and then he can, you know, control the entire vehicle. Then what will happen? Then he can kill so many people. That's another example. And let's say health example. Now, for example, say now, let's say someone is having a pacemaker for a heart, you know, disease. Imagine I can hack that pacemaker, the software. I can kill the person. Now, what we have to do is we have to seriously take care of these, the security of this software. So that is where the cybersecurity comes in. Because all these are on the internet now. Because everything is in the internet. So therefore, we have to be very, very seriously thinking about the cybersecurity aspect.
So let's talk about internet and medicine.
Correct.
How does that connect?
Okay, now simple example. Now, for example, say we are not that much used to, you know, the, for example, let's say we visit a physician to get, you know, consultant physician to get some, you know, medication. And now what you see is like here, mostly like they write that is, you know, prescription. But if you go to the developed world, maybe the United Kingdom or the, you know, the European country, they actually don't write. So they prescribe over the computer. So where do you get that information? They get that information over the internet. Imagine someone hacked that and then changed the information about the medication. What will happen? So that is where the cybersecurity acts onto the medicine. Another example. Now, some we can see now, even the surgeries now, they, for example, say if you want to have a small surgery for a heart attack, and now you don't want to cut and open, right? They do microsurgeries or the nanosurgeries. So then they will be able to put a small stent inside without even cut an opening. So imagine these are, of course, using the technology. Let's say someone hacked that. What will happen? So then the doctor will try to control, but then he won't be able to control any of those, you know, the machineries or the apparatus or equipments. Then someone else will be controlling. Then, of course, there'll be huge damage. So that is where, again, the cybersecurity comes to play in the health sector.
Apart from cybersecurity, I think in the health sector, internet and doing things with technology plays a massive role in terms of medicine.
Correct.
So why don't we speak about the opportunities in that aspect as well?
Okay, now, for example, say, let's say now, there are so many aspects that we can come in. Now, for example, say, we have an area called, like, you know, biomedical engineering. So what we do is, like, there, we just bring information technology into the biosciences, and we can use the, you know, computer technology or, you know, information technology to come up with new solutions to the you know, medical practitioners. So that's a classic example. Now, for example, say, let's say ECG or EEG, right? So when the EEG or ECG is taken, right, from a patient, then before we pass that to the doctor or the consultant doctor, now we have developed systems where, you know, the computer systems analyze it first. And then if there is a mistake, that can be identified through the system that we have already developed. So those systems have artificial intelligence. So therefore, these are artificial intelligence driven systems. So that, of course, I'm not saying that we have to completely rely on these AI-based systems, but those will be supportive systems for the medical practitioners. So therefore, if you are interested in medical and IT, there are plenty of opportunities.
Speaking of AI, I think you would love to talk about artificial intelligence.
Exactly.
So let's touch on what artificial intelligence is. And I know, I understand it's a broad topic and correct. It can go to different aspects of artificial intelligence. But Let's explain what it is in a layman's point of view.
Okay. Artificial intelligence is like, we are trying to make machine intelligent by itself. Now, the humans are always intelligent. In other words, we are going to sort of develop the human intelligence into the machine. That is artificial intelligence. Now, then we might think, where is this artificial intelligence? Now, everywhere it is. Now, for example, let's say we use our phone. Then if you use a Google Map, then Google Map can tell where you are. For example, someone use a Uber. Then Uber will let the other person know where you are. So that is artificial intelligence. So we use all artificial intelligence. For example, nowadays, if you want to get your floor clean, you don't want to get a maid. I can get a small robo. The robo will do the cleaning. So that is artificial intelligence. So therefore, and why it is artificial intelligence is like, because they have the intelligence. Those machines have intelligence. For example, let's say I use a robo. The robo will go to let's say you have a chair here, then he will stop. And he'll go around the chair. So that is the intelligence that the machines has. So this is all about artificial intelligence.
I think we can go on and on about artificial intelligence. And people say that things are getting smarter and humans are getting dumber. Because
the point here is we are going to make the machine smarter, but not smarter than
the human, but they get lazier.
Yeah, they will be lazy, I'm sure.
So we need to do something about that, because we need apps to remind us to kind of work out. We need apps to remind us to drink water.
That's correct.
And there are apps to remind you to fall asleep.
That's true.
And wake up.
Yeah, but actually, in one sense, this is very helpful. Mm-hmm. For example, let's imagine, elderly parent, right? But you are busy. You are so busy. You are not at home, right? And then sometimes they forget to take medication. So then you can have a AI-driven small device, and they'll say, hey, it's your this time, and then the medication time, right? Not only that one. For example, someone has to take medication maybe 4 times a day, and we can even have medication dispenser, but AI-driven. So it will choose correct medication on time and give them a message, hey, this is your medication now. So that is AI.
Now, there's also another fear among people that since robots are being created and they're like, people might lose certain jobs. Mm-hmm. So that's also another thing people fear about most of the time. Mm-hmm. But I don't think that's the case, because to create those robots also you need people.
Exactly.
So correct, what's your view on that?
It is like, this is what we see that. Of course, there are certain skilled jobs that we have, which are repetitive. Actually, for those things, we can use robots. For example, let's say someone who lifts something and plays at some other place, right? It's the production line. And I don't want a human to do that. And it's like raising lifting a product and keeping on that table every time, So I don't want to have that human doing that one. I can use a simple robo because it's repetitive work. So that is where we can use robots. But we will be able to train these people who have been in that into a different area. So therefore, it's a kind of a not really losing jobs, but retraining into a different set of jobs. So the skill set that they have to develop will be completely different. That is a misconception, actually. So we think, if you improve the system using AI or computer system, we might lose a job. It's not. It's a reconfiguration of these people into a different set of skills.
And there's another thing kids would love to do, or even students who are at university level mm-hmm. would want to do, is to get opportunities elsewhere, migrate abroad.
Okay.
So in terms of IT, mm-hmm. what opportunities do our kids have? Maybe now, since you're attached to Canada, mm-hmm. what do you see?
What I see is there are plenty of opportunities for kids who, have experience and also who's planning to engage in information related professions abroad, not only North America, but I can see the same opportunities there in the European region. And then because for example, say if you look at all the large information technology related, or the tech giants, we say most are from the North American and the North American countries. For example, say Apple computer, whatever you name that, most of them are from North America. And they also hire a lot of people. Therefore, there are a lot of opportunities for these guys, our kids, when they go abroad. And then there are different ways that they can make it. For example, say they can graduate from, you know, Sri Lankan institutions, the private or the public universities. They can count a little bit experience, about 2 to 3 years. And of course, there are countries like Canada and so on and so forth. They want skilled people to migrate and then engage in their, their workforce. So therefore, there are opportunities. I think so that will be the common in the, you know, the European market as well.
So do we see a lot of Sri Lankans currently in Canada?
I think so. I think there is a large number of, Sri Lankans. If I would say the number, I would say about 600,000-700,000, Sri Lankans altogether.
That's massive.
It's a massive amount. Yeah, exactly. It's a very large amount. That's correct.
Right.
Yeah.
And we've also come towards the close of the program. So you're here for a purpose.
Actually, we are working on certain projects. Like as I clearly told you, we are pretty much trying to open like avenues for these children to, get education. Mostly we are in the private sector, we are looking at the private sector education. So we are going to enhance the private sector education, the opportunities for these children. And mostly we are looking at the training and retraining opportunities for children. What is it, retraining and training? I also mentioned that, let's, for example, say if a graduate is underemployed, and then, of course, we can retrain that person into a certain different, maybe technical area or maybe technology sector. Or maybe if it is unemployed, we can do the same thing. So therefore, since there are plenty of opportunities out there, so then I think there'll be a lot of opportunities for these kids for the next maybe 10 years.
Well, we would like to wish the kids all the best too. And thank you so much, Professor, for being a part of the show. It was really nice talking to you.
Pleasure to be here. And then thank you for inviting me. Thank you very much.
With that, we wind up November's edition of a special series of programs on Radio Sri Lanka. This was produced by Indira Navagamo and I'm Sharifa Tahir.